What is up, everyone? Welcome to another weekly news video. We have a few things to talk to today regarding Hanky Panky, but also a pretty cool PC video that I saw at some point this week that I think you guys should check out as well. But I want to kick things off with the Fanatics Panini lawsuit. So for those of you that are unaware, which would be a bit strange to be the case right now because everybody has talked about it, Panini is suing Fanatics under an antitrust, you know, legal request or claim, if that's what you want to refer to it as. Now, it's a pretty interesting one that has some pretty big ramifications for the hobby, for the industry. Now, many people have already talked about this, so I won't go into too much detail other than putting you in touch with Paul Lesko on Twitter. He's a lawyer. We've talked to him many times on this channel because he does really good work when it comes to the hobby's lawsuits and sort of explaining it to us in layman's terms. I'll put the thread down below, but it's really long. He gives a lot of good insights. But whilst people have already talked about this, the thing I want to share my thoughts on is why I think this could be a really good thing for the industry and the hobby moving forward. Because whilst some of the claims in here by Panini, and if you read this thread, you'll see it for yourself, are very hypocritical, and it's almost like pot calling the kettle black towards Fanatics because they themselves are guilty of what they're saying Fanatics is. If this lawsuit is won, that would be really good for the hobby because you might end up in a position where you've got multiple producers and manufacturers and printers, whatever you want to refer to them as, releasing, you know, licensed sets at the same time, similar to what we had in the 90s and early 2000s, which I think is a really good thing, right? You don't really want a monopoly ever. Now, Fanatics coming in and being able to streamline the process end-to-end and own platforms and own breaking platforms and auction houses and maybe even a grader eventually is a fantastic thing because it sort of gets rid of all the inefficiencies within the process, right? Tries to create more value for us as customers. But when you've also got that streamlined process and a monopoly, it makes it quite difficult for you as a consumer, right? Because they're going to be able to bend you over a barrel, basically. And if we can sort of have Panini win this lawsuit and be in a point where they can release license cards as well as Fanatics, we're going to get so much more value because competition is what's going to drive the most value generation for us as customers, which I think is a good thing. So hopefully it can get to that point. I want to hear your thoughts down below because so many people are, you know, off Panini completely in the sense that they don't want to hear from them ever again, given what they've done to us in the last few years. And I also agree, but I'm thinking 5-10 years down the line, we're going to be in a better position if you've got more people producing license cards, etc. Now, I'm not overly concerned if Panini don't win because I think there is an opportunity here for unlicensed cards to maybe become a bit more mainstream, especially if Panini keep deciding to produce this kind of card, similar to what Leaf is trying to do. Now, in terms of what Paul Lesko has raised, which was pretty interesting within the lawsuit, is something very silly, according to him, that Panini have done within this, you know, legal document, because they've made a statement here that I'll bring up on screen now, where they're, you know, basically saying a competitive manufacturer also must produce cards of the highest quality according to exacting standards. This is because certain high-end card collectors demand pristine cards. Mint condition cards are highly valued, and a manufacturing provider that cannot produce and package cards so that they reach their ultimate consumer in perfect condition will undermine the product and brand. And the reason why Paul says this is an interesting call out and very strange that they decided to include it is because this could, you know, expose them to their own litigation, right? Because if they're deeming that a card manufacturer should be producing cards at a mint condition level, anytime somebody gets a card from Panini that comes with QC issues out of the pack or sends it to a grader and it does not get a mint grade, does that now mean that they can go back to Panini and say, you guys need to give us a replacement that does meet the conditions, the standards that you are specifying? That is a very real possibility by putting this kind of language into this document, which is pretty interesting. And Paul, again, talks to this element. So check out the thread so you can see it for yourself. But it's just, you know, an interesting one where, and now you've got Panini doing something, again, incredibly idiotic. So just to kind of watch this space kind of thing, have they exposed themselves here? If this lawsuit does go ahead, what does this mean for the mess they've basically done for the last 4 to 5 years when it comes to terrible QC? But, you know, let me know your thoughts down below and we can chat to that as always. Now, the next thing I'm going to talk to is Sports Card Radio's live from the other day because I think they did a really good job highlighting a few things. They spoke to the Fanatics and Panini lawsuit. Then they also talked to PWCC and some of their trimming allegations in the past. Now, a big talking point for them was how many people are still out there sort of defending PWCC wholeheartedly or trying to, I don't know if the term whitewash is the right word, or wash away, I think is what I'm trying to say, the issues they've had in the past and make it out like they're not there anymore. But the thing I want to reiterate to you guys, especially the new people, is the things we spoke to about 2 months ago when we spoke about this soccer syndicate, right, where you had you know, these guys making fake stickers, fake rookie cards, sending them into all the graders, mostly ending up in BGS slabs. BGS can't tell they're fake. They end up on PWCC's platform and people get screwed over, ended up buying a fake card and then don't really have any recourse. The reason why I want to talk about this again today is because that stuff is still happening. And what we did talk to in that video is that PWCC know that BGS have a problem. We highlighted a comment on Instagram from their senior fraud analyst where he basically said that collectors can say that they're fake, BGS don't, and BGS think they're right, so we can't really do anything about it. And what I did talk to in that video is that PWCC have a terrible risk appetite, so much so that they're allowing these cards to still go on their platform even though they have knowingly commented and talked to the fact that they know they're fake, collectors know they're fake, but BGS are saying it's fine. Like, that's just a weird position to be in. And when you're trying to wash away the history of PWCC and all the issues they've had, and then you also try and ignore that sort of stuff or not even know about it, you need to be across this kind of thing. You need to understand this kind of thing because it's not, you know, a one and done problem for them. This stuff is persistent and it's happening day in, day out. And you're seeing it on their auctions every few weeks. Another one of these cards pops up and they don't do anything about it. It's like you'd expect a business in the modern age where you've got so much more money involved and all this sort of thing, doing the right thing by their customers. And the fact that they know BGS have a problem and still allow BGS slabs of rookie and vintage soccer stickers to end up on their auction house to be sold to then to a collector who is basically shit out of luck if they do end up buying it is really poor form in my opinion. And that's the kind of thing that you sort of need to be angry about at PWCC. If you think the shill bidding stuff is BS, which I don't think it is, my personal opinion is there's some, you know, evidence there to suggest that it has happened, right? Check out Sports Car Radio's videos in their website. If you want to ignore that stuff, how can you ignore this stuff currently happening right now? Like, there's these businesses, I'll say it time and time again, I'll say it again, they have a terrible risk appetite. They're so quick to charge you more money and take advantage of you and get all your money from you as a customer, but they don't want to uplift their process and do the right thing. This is another one of those cases. And let me know your thoughts on this one down below and check out the video that I put up on screen before, because I think it's, you know, a very important one to understand because it's a big bloody problem. You're not talking about cheap cards, you're talking about very, very expensive ones. Now, the next thing is going to be the sports card nonsense interview they did with Gary V out at the National. Now, Mike Geo asked a pretty good question here. They wanted to understand, you know, why, where did Gary go, right? Why is he not talking about cards anymore? And Gary basically gives a response that when he talked about cards, people shit on him for being a pumper. And now that he stopped talking about cards, people are saying he's a pump and dumper, right? And he's basically left and they're angry at him for leaving. So he doesn't know what he needs to be doing, right? He talks about cards, he gets shit on. He doesn't talk about cards, he gets shit on. Which I thought was a bit of a cop-out answer, to be honest. And I'm really keen to get your thoughts on this if you haven't seen it. But the reason why I think it's a bit of a cop-out answer is because that, again, plays into that same mindset that people have of him as being a pump and dumper, right? For all the hate that Jeff Wilson gets for doing the same sorts of things that, you know, Gary Vee's accused of, right? At least Jeff stuck around and he's still here day in, day out producing content and he's getting grilled for all this sort of stuff. But Gary, at the height of the, you know, the hobby, tells you to go buy base rookies that are printed to death and have, you know, 18,000 plus pop reports. And then as soon as the market dips, he disappears. You know, I think if you're going to be, you know, picking on the one of two of those, I know which one I'd be picking on, and that would be Gary. And I would love to interview him or even talk to him at some point, even off the record. If I was at the National, I would have loved to have asked him this question. Like, how can you sort of be comfortable doing that, right? How can you be comfortable saying all these things and not being there? You know, my suggestion would be if you want to be a public figure and you want to be the face of a hobby and you want to be talking about all these kinds of things, okay, yeah, you might not have the time, but you need to have some kind of obligation to the people watching, right? And if you're somebody that doesn't want to have those accusations toward you, because maybe from his perspective, he was being genuine, you know, me personally, I'd be wanting to make sure that people didn't think like that about me. Now, you could say, who cares what people think, but it goes beyond that because people have followed his advice and got burned, right? They've lost money because of it. So from my perspective, if I was in his shoes, I'd be, okay, let's put out content every now and then to show that I'm still connected to the hobby, to show that I'm still passionate about it, not only talk about it every 12 months when the National rolls around, right? I just think it's a bit of a cop-out from him, this response. I'm keen to get your thoughts. And that would basically be the question I'd ask him. Why did you basically disappear? That's not good enough, your answer here. Why have you not, you know, stuck around and talked more? Because you saying people shit on you whether you talk about it or don't talk about it, they're the same problem. If people saying you're a pump and dumper, obviously you're not going to talk about it when the market's not up anymore. So the messaging would be, talk about it freaking more, Gary. So let me know your thoughts down below. And I know I probably just went on a bit of a rant, but I just think it's an interesting one, because if you're going to point fingers at Jeff Wilson, right, because people love to do that, he's the easy guy to pick on, he's the easy target, you know, why don't you pick on this guy 10 times harder? Because like I said, at least Jeff is still freaking around talking about things and sometimes making himself look like an idiot, where he still looks like he doesn't know a whole lot about cards, but at least he's still here, right? At least he's still doing this content week in, week out. At least he's still seemingly caring about the hobby. You can say what you want about him, but at least he's still here. That's some credit to the guy that he does deserve, irrespective of what you think of him. Now, as I think I touched on at the start, the cool PC that I think I want to talk to you about is Wax Museum Podcast. I love this guy's content. I talk about it all the time. He did a really cool thing when it came to a custom, you know, LOGOMAN card that he had built of Allen Iverson. It is a game-worn LOGOMAN, or game-used, I think it's referred to as, or pre-match-worn, something along those lines. But check out this video here. It's really cool. In my opinion, this is what collecting is all about. And I really enjoyed his actually McDonald's Happy Meal toys, especially this one here when he's looking for the Reggie Miller. No spoilers, but it's a fun one. But he just does, you know, really cool content. He's got a podcast too, which I listen to every now and then. But his content epitomizes to me what the hobby is all about, because you can clearly tell he's a collector. He loves cards. He loves his team, the Indiana Pacers. Just the things he talks about and the things he goes about buying, I think, is just really cool. So if you're not switched on to him, please check him out, because his stuff is, you know, probably my favorite thing to watch in the hobby when it comes to card collecting and all that sort of stuff, because he does things like I like to do them. It's just so much fun to watch. So please check it out. So this was a very long one. I do apologize. I feel like I say that often, but there's just a few things there that I wanted to talk to. Please let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, and I will see you in the next one. Cheers.